that we are discussing here is from the company Intuit. And I'll also discuss with the small introduction to the companies from now on. I mean, with every video when I'm going to give you the problems, that means the problems that was asked in their interviews. At the same time, I'll also give you a small introduction to that company itself. Okay. Now, for example, here we are discussing the problems led to the company, which is Intuit. Now, what does Intuit do? Intuit is actually a firm which creates business and accounting softwares. And it is based on Mountain View, California. And this company is having annual turnover of around somewhere around $5 to $7 billion. Okay, so it was founded in 1983, which is around 35 years ago, and so office is in Palo Alto, California, and the key people here is Brad Smith, who is the CEO of the company. Okay, and the revenue, which is in 2017, was around $5.177 billion, and where the operating income was $1.395 billion. Okay, so these things actually help you when you are going for the interviews of these companies, because sometimes, I mean, it's important for you to have a little bit idea, related to the background of the company. What does they do? What are the products that they create? What are their famous products? As well as in whatever departments you are going to get in. For example, let us say that you want to apply for the accounting department. So let us say you want to apply for the development department. Then you should know in specifically for which project you are interested, or for which product they are hiring you, because that creates a positive impact to the HR or to the employer, because they know that you are already interested in the company, and then you are also, you know, applying for a specific position, and you have a brief idea of brief background, or you have some skills that is going to help you in that particular project, because if you demonstrate those skills in that project, then that will help you out you know, in the interview process itself. Okay, so first of all, let us read out the problem here. The problem says, find out the maximum subarray of a non-negative integers of an array. The subarray, which should be contiguous, that is the sum array created by choosing the second and the fourth element and skipping the third element, is invalid. Okay, for example, what does it mean that if we have an array like this, okay, they are going to give you any array as an input. Let us say this is the array which they are giving you as an input. Okay, now find out the maximum subarray of non-negative integers. Okay, that means we have to give a subarray of this which is not having any negative integers. Okay, and the subarray should be contiguous, continuous should be there. For example, in this subarray, let us say if I have the numbers 1, 2, 5. Now, these numbers are continuous. Okay, but I cannot take the numbers of subarray which is 1, 2, 5, 2. Okay, because here, because of this minus 7 is a negative integer number. Okay, because of this, we cannot choose this minus 7 as a negative integer number. And secondly, because we cannot choose minus 7, so this entire array which is 1, 2, 5 and 2, this entire array will not be continuous. Okay, so contiguous means all the numbers in the subarray should be contiguous. For example, here, if I take this part of this array, which is 1, 2, 5, now this part is actually contiguous. Okay, so we cannot skip any element between them. So we have to take all the elements continuously. Secondly, the maximum subarray is defined in terms of the sum of the elements. So it is, if I say 1 plus 2 plus 5, so total sum is 8. Okay, so the total sum of the subarray is 8, and that is how they are defining the maximum subarray. And secondly, for example, if you have a subarray A, it is greater than the subarray B if the sum of A and the sum is greater than the sum of B. Now, for example, here, if I take, let us say the first subarray here is 1, 2, 5. So that is 1 plus 2 plus 5. So the total sum is 8. And if I take this subarray, which is having 2 plus 3, so total sum here is 5. So the first subarray, assuming this first subarray is X and second subarray is Y. So the first subarray is greater than the second subarray, because the sum of the first subarray is greater than the sum of second subarray. Okay, but it can happen that we can have a tie. Now, what happens if we have a tie? If there is a tie, then compare with segment length. Okay, that means if, let us say, the sum of this subarray is 8, and here also the sum of this subarray, instead of 3, if we have 6, the sum of this subarray is also 8. Both the subarrays are having the same sum. In that case, return the segment which is having the maximum length. For example, here this is having the maximum length, which is total 3, but this subarray is having a maximum length, which is 2. So in case we have a tie, in that case we have to choose a subarray which is having a maximum length. But still, let us say we have the second array which is also having length as 3. In that case, if there's still a tie, then return the segment which is having the minimum starting index. For example, here the minimum starting index is 0, but let us say its segment length is 3, this segment length is also 3. In that case, you have to return the subarray which is having the starting index as 0, only in the case when both of them are having the same sum. Okay. Now, how the input is given? Input is like this. The first line contains the integer t, denoting the number of test cases. That means how many test cases we are going to have. We are going to have 10, 20, 30, 40 and so on. And the constant is like that, in maximum we are going to have 40 test cases. From 1 to 40, that means at maximum we will be having 40 test cases. Secondly, the following t lines contain integer n, depicting the size of the array. Okay, and the next line followed by the values. For example, here we will be having integer n which is denoting the size of the array. So as we can see here, the constant is saying the size of the array cannot be greater than 100. So before creating the program itself, we can define or we can create an array which is having the maximum size is 100. Okay, and then in the output we are going to print the sum, the subarray and the maximum sum. Okay, let me take some demo values to explain this one. Okay, assuming that if we are saying in the input, if we are saying that we have 2, that means we are going to give approximately of 2 test cases here, and the first test case is having 3. 3 means this is denoting the test case, and this 3 here, it is denoting the size of the first array. And assuming that the first array is having the size which is 3 and the values are 1, 2 and 3. Okay, that came the first subarray. And we can have the second subarray, the second test case which is having the size as 2, and this subarray can also be having some values, and assuming that the values are -1 and 2, so they are -1 and 2. Okay, so this is the first test case. As you can see, the first test case, a subarray which is of size 3, they are giving the values. This is the second test case, a subarray which is having a size 2, and these are the values. Okay, now when you are going to give the output, in the output you have to give that subarray. Now the first test case, you can see there is no negative value in the entire array. Therefore, this can be boundary case where the entire array can be created as a subarray. Okay, because they are asking a subset. So they are not asking a proper subset, but rather they are asking a subset. Okay, so the output here will be 1, 2, 3 for the first test case, and for the second test case, we cannot choose this value because we have to give a subarray which is having non-negative integers. So there's only 2 values. So out of this, this is the only small value that we have. This is the only value that we have, which is maximum. So the output is 2. So output will be 1, 2, 3 and 2. So these outputs are always in the second line, or the next line. I hope that you understood the problem here. I'll give you the solutions in the next video. That is, what are the approaches that you can follow to give the solutions of this video. Now you can stop here and you can start writing your program. I've already explained you the program here. I've already explained you the input. I've already explained you the output. I've already explained you the problem. Now your job is to create a program to solve this problem. Okay. And thank you so much for watching. Now let us move on to the next video. Okay.